Good morning, everyone. Thank you so much for inviting me here to Tisha. It's been really lovely. It's such a lovely warm day outside, and I've had such a lovely warm welcome here this morning as well. Thank you. So for those of you who don't know me, I'm Colleen Savage. I'll give you a little bit about my background. You probably understand, you're probably thinking, oh, where's that accent coming from? So I was originally born and bred in South Africa. And in my 20s, I moved to New Zealand and married an amazing Kiwi man and have two daughters who are now 13 and 17. They are singing at our church in Wall's End today, which is why they can't be here. And I have a teaching background. I've been teaching all levels, all ages, from early learning, from early childhood right through to adults in New Zealand, and then came over to Australia teaching primary school. And I was very involved in children's ministries at our church in Castle Hill in Sydney. And then alongside that, I was also doing my master's in social work and have a real passion for working with families and children who are vulnerable. And I got a job in that. And just before I was going to start, I got a call from Adrian at the North New South Wales conference asking me, Colleen, would you consider being the Family and Children's Ministries Director for North New South Wales? And I thought, wow, I'm a week away from starting my dream job. And what do I do? And I thought, well, God's called me. And a few days later, my 16-year-old daughter asked me, she said, Mum, so what are you going to do? So I said, oh, I want to, you know, God's called me, but I'm afraid. And she said, but Mum, working for God is not meant to be easy. Wow. My 16-year-old daughter is telling me this. I've got to be a role model and I've got to do this because I've got God on my side. So yeah, preaching is a new thing for me. So so I'm sure you'll understand, but I hope you'll be blessed. So being family and children's ministries, I like to pick topics that'll reach everybody of all ages because it's children and families. And I'm glad to hear that you are doing children's church next week. I wish I could be here. I'm in Port Macquarie for a children's program up there, but I'd love to see photos of it. Please send me photos. And I'd love to share these kind of things on our children's ministry's Facebook page for other churches to get ideas from to what to do as well. So thank you for that. Before I start, I'd just like to have another quick prayer. Lord, thank you for everyone here at Singleton Church today. Please bless them and their families. And as we choose a topic today that affects all of us, may you speak through me and may it reach the hearts that need to be reached. In your name, amen. So I have an older sister of a younger twin brother and sister. So as growing up, these two were always very, very close, and I was always felt ganged up against. Can anyone relate to that? I see some smiles. Hand up at the back. Ken, you've got five brothers, you said. Yeah. All right. So does anyone else here have brothers and sisters? Yeah, so you can all relate a little bit to what sibling rivalry is. Yes, so you all got some experience. So here are a few ways that it might happen in your home or your grandkids' home. Your three-year-old son or grandson accidentally sits on his two-month-old baby brother while he's lying on a playmat. When you ask your oldest son what happened, he says, I don't like the baby. I don't want him to live here anymore. Or, 1 minute, your 5 and 7-year-old daughters are playing happily with their trains, and the next minute, they're screaming about who gets to push the blue train around the track. By the time you get to their bedroom, they're crying and refusing to play with each other anymore. Oopsie. And the next one, after dinner, your three teens, aged 12, 14, and 16, start arguing about what show to watch on TV before bed. There's no consensus, so each child thinks their pick should win. OK, Can you relate to that, any of those? Other examples include verbal or physical fighting, name calling, tattling and bickering, being in constant competition for parental attention, and voicing feelings of envy. Sound familiar to anyone? Very quiet. Does it just sound familiar to anyone? Thank you. We're all human. It happens to all of us. If you do any of these following, even unknowingly, you could be setting yourself and your kids up for a lot of angst. Constantly praise one. So if you do any of these things, you could just be setting yourself and your children up for angst. So constantly praise one child and criticize another, put your kids against one another in competition, assign specific family roles, such as Sam is the math quiz or Charlie is the artist. Clearly pay more attention to one child's needs and interests. So I thought, where's our little clicker? Let's go look and see what the dictionary says about sibling rivalry. So it says sibling rivalry is the competition between siblings, especially for the attention, affection, and approval of their parents. And according to observational studies by Judith Dunn, children as young as 1 year old are sensitive by differences in how their parents treat them. It's actually by a story. I've just received a little a rescue dog. I had a dog that's 2 years old that's been with us. And just about 3 weeks ago, we got a new rescue dog, a little puppy as well. And it's amazing. I could even tell in our dogs, my older dog being jealous of the younger dog that has come in. It's been really interesting to watch. But why do rivalries continue in adults? Even beyond middle age, siblings still remember the way they felt treated when they were kids. This affects their relationships with each other and their psychological well-being. It sticks with us, research says. This is especially true in severe or unhealthy conflict, but it can happen with milder cases too. It really depends on the meaning that people attach in the past events. Therapist Omar Ruiz puts it this way: kids are impulsive, adults are intentional. You have choices and skills that you didn't have back then. Who here has experienced sibling rivalry? Have a think about what caused it? How did you start it out and what sorted it? Or is it still brewing today? So I like going back to the Bible. Families in the Bible didn't have it all together, and neither do we. What we see in scripture is more dysfunctional than functional, especially when it comes to sibling rivalry. Sibling rivalry is real, and because the Bible is based on reality, sibling rivalry can also be found in scripture. Let's look at the case where one sibling, let's say Abel, let's call him Abel, is good and well-behaved, while other, shall we say, Cain, is getting into trouble. They're both asked to do the same job, maybe tidy their room. Abel does exactly what is asked, but the other, Cain, gets easily distracted. After a while, they compare the two rooms, and it is clear that one of the siblings will be in trouble because they did not do as asked. Sorry? Cain is then able and angry because he did what was right and got the recognition for it. But in the Bible, it was not a room that was asked to be tidied. It was to make an offering to God. Abel followed instructions, whereas Cain did not. Cain was angry and jealous with his brother, as God had accepted Abel's offering, but not Cain's. Instead, God gave Cain a warning about sin. In this case, his sin was an all-consuming jealousy against his brother. Cain's anger towards Abel ended in murder. What lesson can we learn from this? It is obedience to God that is accepted, not what we think is acceptable. Sibling rivalry came out of Cain wanting his works to be recognized the same as Abel's, but he did not understand that it's not works, but obedience that God wants. Cain thought he could get Abel to think and act the same way as he did, but instead Abel sided with God. Cain knew that Abel was doing the right thing, but knowing that Abel was doing the right thing showed up Cain's sin even more. Jealousy and pride can lead to some angry and harmful feelings. If we can go to our Bibles in 1 John 3, verse 11 and 12, please. 1 John 3, verse 11 and 12, and we'll also read verse 15. For this is the message that you have heard from the beginning, that we should, what? Love one another. We should not be like Cain, who was of the evil one and murdered his brother. And why did he murder him? Because his own deeds were evil and his brother's righteous. Don't be surprised, brothers, that the world hates you. Verse 15, everyone who hates his brother is a murderer, and you know that no murderer has eternal life abiding in him. This story reminded me of, when I did social work and counseling, and I would talk about families who are experiencing a lot of anger, and I'd often talk about this analogy over here, where anger is the iceberg, it's the part that you see. You see that?